Good morning.
Hello. Hello, everyone.
Mark, I shared a link of an art demo.
Yeah, I saw that. That looks really interesting.
For acrylics, because if you listen to it, then they send you samples.
Yeah.
They send you a box of stuff.
That's cool. Maybe we'll, because it's on a Wednesday, which is the same time as like the Zoom session will be. So maybe I'll just do that instead.
It's the week before. It's before.
Oh, it's the week before. Okay, yeah. Cool.
But I put it on the, I arranged it for the time, the same time that we meet. But okay. I talked to the lady and she said she was hoping for at least 20 and they could have up to 99 and it's okay share it.
Okay. I'll put that out to my other class as well. It's really cool. Yeah. I like those demos because you do get the free thing if you sort of sign up and, it's fun. It's really informative. Yeah.
Okay, good.
All right. So let me just do something else here. All right, so we'll give it a minute and or a few minutes, and we'll jump in and get started here. Let me just prep some stuff and then we'll get going.
Janet, my garden roses.
They're beautiful. I think I might have some of that same plant of that pink one. Is it very fragrant? The one with light in the middle and then dark on the outside?
Yes.
It's very fragrant and very prolific, like yes. 60 roses at a time on the...
Right, yeah. So this time, because we did the cutting and all that in October, so they are just like, they were one bud here and this was full bloom. But today they are both blossoms, but they're really fragrant.
Yes,
I mean, they just smell in the whole room, so which is great.
They're beautiful. Yes, I trimmed mine in October also and fertilized because yes. That's the last time that you're supposed to fertilize. Right. And mine also, especially that one, that's the best of all of my rose bushes.
Yeah. I have like black prints and all that stuff, which is really, really cool. They're just like dark maroon, like a black prints. That's almost black rose, which is also fragrant.
Oh.
Yeah, lots of, because I love roses.
Beautiful, thank you for sharing.
I know, thank you. Just wanted to show you, to start that morning. How are you, Mike?
Hello, okay. I think we can go ahead and get started. I'm good. Sorry about the last couple of weeks. Things have been really hectic over on my end, even prior to that, but yeah. Just getting sick was really sort of the kind of the straw that broke the camel's back. So I apologize for missing the last 2 weeks, but it was Thanksgiving, so I think it sort of worked out all right.
Yeah, we are sorry, Mark, because you lost your cousin, and we were really, really sad to know that loss.
Yeah.
It is really hard on the family and everybody. I mean, this is ridiculous, you know.
Yeah, it kind of came out of the blue, and no one, I mean, he's not too young, but I mean, no one really sort of expected it. He's 54. So and he had no other signs of any other pre-existing conditions. It just, you know, middle of the night kind of thing. So yeah, we're still kind of processing and dealing with all that. But you know, this is a good way to sort of deal with that. Just kind of put your nose to the grindstone and keep working and do things and stay busy. So here I am. So I still have a little bit of a cough. So sometimes I'll mute the mic so I'm not like coughing into the mic and blowing out your eardrums. So if there's like a long pause, it's sometimes because of that. I'm also like eating, you can't see it, eating endless cough drops. So hopefully I can kind of stave it off. So even though we missed the last couple weeks, I do feel like there was plenty on the plate. I never really got around to doing the portrait like I had planned. It just kind of like, it was one thing after another. And so I never got around to doing the portrait, but there was sort of the previous videos on, it was the frontal portrait, but similar in terms of information, aside from just changing the position. But like I was saying, there's plenty of things to continue to work on or revisit if the case sort of, if the opportunity arose. Yes, Gina.
Yes, what session was the frontal portrait? What did we call that? I was looking in the modules because I finished that and I was looking for the module to submit it, and I don't know, I kind of came up empty. Maybe I didn't look hard enough.
Week 13.
13 was the frontal portrait. Okay.
Well, the frontal portrait was from the beginning class, the three-quarter portrait, which was just kind of a modified one. Either one, though. Okay. Like, if you wanted to do the frontal or three-quarter, you had that option.
Okay, because I did the frontal one because I remember you, I don't know, doing something. And then I was looking to submit it, and I couldn't find the module. So, okay, that explains it then. Okay.
So yeah, you could submit it to the three-quarter portrait, and that's totally fine. Yeah.
Yeah, and how long do we have, like, if we submit it like in the next week, will you look at it, or when does it all go away?
Yeah. Okay. So that's a great question. So I'll be grading and responding to all of the submissions. I'm finally kind of catching back up with everything. So I'll be responding and leaving my feedback to all of your submissions. And that'll happen this week. So if you submit anything this week as well, I'll be responding and grading that too. You have access to the class. It'll show up on your Canvas dashboard up through the 31st of this month, so through the whole month. After that point, you still have access to all of the content, so all of the modules you will have continual access to in your previous courses. So if you search through your previous courses over on the far left side, it'll show up.
Okay, I did not realize we could access the previous courses. Okay.
Yeah, so if you need to like watch a video or reread something, you can continue to do that, but you don't have access to the assignments or any quizzes or any of that stuff. So I don't know if that means that you won't see the feedback that I've left. So you might want to, I don't know, make sure you check that out if there's any.
Will we be able to see the videos though, I mean the recordings?
Yes.
Of the class? Okay.
Yeah. So all the pages you'll be able to look through. Mm-hmm. I'm pretty sure all the assignments you'll be able to look through. You just won't be able to submit anything. And I don't know if that means that you won't be able to see your previous submissions, which is where you'd see my comments.
Okay.
All so, right. But good. you do have access, continual access to the course modules, as long as you're registered for other classes and have access to MiraCosta Canvas.
And Mark, you didn't, I know you aren't finishing this recorded portrait, but is there any way, are you planning on going over some of it? Or should we just submit? I'm stuck. I don't want painting until I get the drawing right.
Sure. I mean, if you
and direction of the nose, that kind of
thing. If you want to send me any images that you're working on, I can give you some feedback to that. Okay. And that's totally fine. Like I said, I'm trying to like chip away at all of the things that I need to grade still. But I'm going to do it and it will get done and you'll see my responses this week. But if you have a more pressing sort of immediate concern, please feel free to email me. And I do respond to the emails. So, as long as I get them, I'm responding to whatever I see. If I don't respond to you and you send me an email, just send it again. Maybe it gets lost in the mix.
Yeah.
I teach at two other schools, so three total. And it's like this deluge of like happy holidays or this person's retiring or, you know, like just nonstop kind of email all day long. So it's really easy for things to get a little bit lost in the mix. So if I skip over and don't respond to you, feel free to just send it back to me and I'll respond. What other news is there? Janet shared a golden acrylics lecture that's going to take place Wednesday, January 11th from 9 to 11. And I've been to a couple of these previously where an artist will introduce and discuss all the sort of all the different materials that a company produces. They'll go through and sort of explain some of the, for this one, it's golden acrylics, which is a really high quality acrylic paint. So they'll talk about some of the different mediums, some of the different paints, and how you might use them and utilize them in different ways. And it's very informative and it's really interesting. And it says that after you fill out an online survey, you can receive free paint samples. Yeah. So I'm going to post the link to that for you to register. And this is before class actually starts. And this is through the Carlsbad Adventure Art Club. So I'm going to post a link to that. So please feel free to register. And Janet said that it's open to everyone. And if you can invite other people, so feel free to share that link so that way people can register for it as well. I think it's really interesting. It's very informative and free stuff is always fun. So especially free art supplies. Yeah. Did I miss anything, Janet?
No, thank you. And I put it in the chat also.
Okay, great. I'll post a like a page for that in this module, in this week's module, so that way you have sort of access to that. So this week is our last week. This kind of came up pretty quickly, so I'm glad that I'm around to have this last session with y'all. For this week's module, it is more informational. Last week we had the assignment, and I'm gonna focus more on what we were supposed to do last week. But I just want to cover, just start off with this week's content and just walk you through it so that way you can see what's in there. So let me see. All right, I think I'm ready for that. Okay. So for this week, we're just looking at mainly just a lot of different information. And a lot of this is applicable more so to like acrylic and oil painting, but I do feel like there's some information here that's that we can kind of like shift over to watercolor. Okay, so this first page is really about the idea of texture and the difference between implied texture and actual texture. With acrylic and oil paint, the paint is so thick and gloopy that you can actually get physical texture from the paint. But that's not the only way to kind of create texture. We can do it visually as well, meaning that we can replicate like the fur of an animal or the sheen and smoothness of like a metal surface. In both of these pieces here, these are both by the artist Glenn Brown. One is just like paint just sort of piped almost like cake icing on top of itself. And the other one is an actual painting that replicates the idea of all of the different kind of mushy streaks of paint mixing together. And these are all sort of, all of these little strokes here are individually painted. It's very precise. He's a very delicate and intricate painter, and his work is really amazing. So I do suggest that you take a look at it. He kind of pulls references from the Renaissance, from science fiction, pulpy kind of images, and he combines them all together with this very masterful painting technique that he has. So texture can be both that physical thing and also the implied texture, meaning the visual look. You know, if we took a photo of like a puppy, you know, it and printed that out, it's not like we could touch the photograph and feel the fur. All we're really seeing is just a visual representation of that fur. And so we could do the same thing with painting. It's just a visual representation. It's not a textural thing. And that's a very kind of obvious thing to say, but it's sometimes important to just kind of point out the basic ideas, because, you know, we could make physical texture on a painting surface if our paint allows it, but with watercolor, we can't really do that. We're sort of stuck with the flatness of the surface, the flatness of the paint. In these videos here, I just have a few videos where the artist gives you some tips on how to maybe replicate some textures. I really like this guy. I think it's Draw Mix Paint. He's very he's very succinct and very straightforward with his painting techniques. He's a really good painter. He's not overly fussy. So I really like his videos. And in this, he kind of goes through a few different types of objects and talks about how you might approach it. And really, the key to actually both of these videos here is the same thing that we've been kind of covering continually throughout the semester, which is it always comes back to shape. We're not painting a thing, we're just making a shape of color or a shape of value. So as long as you put the shape in the right place and it's the right value or the right color, it's going to look like what it's supposed to look like. And you can even see that just in these screen grabs here for these metallic objects. It's not like this artist is making like metallic Christmas ornaments. This is really just like a shape of red with a different shape of red on it, with a different shape of red above it, with a little shape of white. And so it's really, that's really all it is. It's just shape of color. This last video here is on monoprinting, which is a really interesting technique of almost half painting, half printing, where you paint on top of a surface, usually it's glass, and then you lay your paper on top of it and then run it through the printing press, and it'll basically stamp that image onto your paper. You could do different textural things depending on like what's behind it. So this is a good video on exploring texture with monoprinting. The next bit of information is all about scale. Now, scale is an important thing when it comes to painting, or when it comes to all art in general. Scale is really about kind of our relationship to the object, the viewer's relationship to the object, also the artist. Generally, when we paint, we want to like fill the page as large as possible and kind of like compose it in a way that makes the most sense. But we can shift and play around with scale in art. And so the first thing is like going small, right? So there's a time and a place to kind of work really, really tightly and really intricately. This is a miniature painting. It's Persian and it's 8 inches by 11 inches. So no bigger than a sheet of paper. And it's got all of these like tiny details, not just in the image itself, but all along the border too. And it's almost like Where's Waldo, where it's this, just this mash of information. There's so much going on because the scale is so much smaller than the overall picture plane kind of allows. You see this in other work, like sort of famously Hieronymus Bosch's Garden of Earthly Delights. A lot of altarpieces use the same kind of idea where, you know, they're packing as much information and activity into a painting as possible. And so, you know, this is 8 by 11 isn't that big. You know, it's just a standard sheet of paper. But imagine doing this over something that's like 3 feet by 2 feet. All of a sudden, you have even more real estate to kind of jam full of information. So scale, like on the small scale, has this level of intimacy that can be really overwhelming. You know, there's so much to look at here. you know, you can kind of get lost in each one of these little vignettes that are happening throughout the entire painting. On the opposite end is working extra large, you know, going so big that it becomes beyond the capacity of your physical reach. And that's also a very interesting way to work as well. Generally, when we work on something, we're painting and we have, you know, we're working on it at arm's length at the most. You know, we can't overreach. But the moment that you start to work even larger, you know, you're only seeing a piece of the entire thing, kind of like the forest for the trees sort of situation. And you really have to have a better understanding of what this thing looks like from a distance. We can see in this image here, this is Claire Tabaret, who's an amazing painter. Here she is for scale. And these are some gigantic canvases. And she's using an old fire hydrant to spray paint onto the surface, just to kind of build up a surface. But you can see that the actual finished paintings are in progress paintings here, and how large they are. And this is all going to be painted by hand. So the streak of this highlight on his leg, you know, that's about probably 3 feet or 4 feet. So that's a 4-foot brush stroke that you have to make and understand where it goes and how that looks and the relationship to everything else that's happening on the canvas. And that's a very kind of interesting place to make work from as well. And it's very similar to, you know, murals. That's also a very large scale painting. And this is just a nice video on making a mural. Now, the logistics of making a really large painting, you know, it's not something that we deal with necessarily. You know, we're working on sort of handheld, reasonable amounts of paper. So the approach is slightly different than what we're used to, but it's not out of the question. I don't have the video here. I think I've shown the video previously of my friend Conrad Ruiz, who made, he was saying the largest watercolor painting or watercolor disaster painting ever made. And it was about 20 feet, I think, by 20 feet. It's really large. And he's doing the whole thing in watercolor. So the technique is kind of the same. You know, we're not working vertically. So he has to like do a section of it on a table, roll up the painting, move on to a new section and roll up the painting and move on and so on and so forth. But he has to just trust that whatever it is that he's looking at, whatever shapes he's trying to paint and whatever color he's trying to paint, that he just trusts that it's going to make sense when it all comes together. And it did, and it's a really amazing painting. But there's, you know, other materials, there's spray paint, there's acrylic paint, and those have much better capacity to work vertically. I think it's interesting to combine different techniques of both watercolor and acrylic and pencil drawing. And I think that's really exciting. So these are some videos on just some different techniques used to make large paintings. This first video is using stencils with spray paint. The last video is on painting a billboard, which is very much like a mural, but except you're high up, you know, like on scaffolding basically, and you're only painting. I have a friend who actually used to paint billboards with his family, and you know, you're up on top of the billboard post and you're really only painting like a 4-foot by 4-foot section. And then you have to like carry everything that you're bringing to the next 4-foot by 4-foot section. And the read of the painting is way different up close than it is from far away. And so that's a tough thing to kind of like leap over. And then this painting in the middle is on Gerhard Richter doing some squeegee paintings where he'll layer paint and then use a squeegee to kind of scrape away and create the non-representational painting. He makes other types of paintings, but that's sort of one of the things that he's famous for. And then to round out this week's module, I have a video here where this is actually a little bit older, where we shared a space with another friend of ours, but this is my studio out here in Riverside that I share with my friend, Chet Glaze. And it's just a warehouse in like an industrial park. It's a lot of fun. We get to do things and make things, and it's a great space to work. So it's a small little tour of that. And then the last page here is I gave an artist talk on basically all my work kind of for the last 20 years, I think. And normally I'm a little, the word's sort of escaping me. I'm not as forthcoming with talking about my work, but in this lecture, for whatever reason, I was very frank about it. I was very like open about kind of my motivations and my ideas. So I think it's a pretty good talk, and it's an hour long and you can watch it and see some of my work. And then I also have an in process where I'm actually working on a painting or a couple different paintings in this video right here. So there's two videos of me that you can check out if this isn't enough of me. All right. So that's all the information from this week, but what we're really focused on is last week's stuff. And this is, if you were in the summer class, this is repeated information from the summer, but the assignment is different this time around. All right, so on this first page, I'm not gonna kind of read through this verbatim. I think you can do that on your own time. But basically I talk about this idea that, you know, out in the world, we're looking to kind of capture some of the most amazing moments of our life. You know, we walk around, we go on vacation, we go out to eat, you know, we take pictures in front of like beautiful monuments and like beautiful scenery and amazing looking food. And we're not alone in that pursuit. Like everyone kind of does it. Like we all go to the Eiffel Tower and take that picture. Or, you know, even in this photograph in the next one, you know, we've got a group of people basically all taking the same photo. They're all participating in the same thing. And the results might be slightly different, but it's all basically the same. And, you know, we can talk more about that, but what it really comes down to is some of these pursuits can be a little bit cliche. It could be a little bit repetitive to what it is that's already out there. The thing that we're trying to capture is sort of in our mind's eye something we've seen before. So what does that kind of leave us with? And it's sort of this weird moment where, you know, are these people really enjoying the scenery, or are they like just doing what they feel obligated to do, which is take a picture of the scenery. I mean, like I said, talk endlessly about that. But, you know, painting roses and taking pictures of roses. You guys were just talking about roses at the beginning of class. You know, as well as these are painted, and if we were to photograph roses, as good as a photograph of a rose is, they pale in comparison to the actual rose. It doesn't have the same quality. It doesn't smell the same. It doesn't sort of occupy the same amount of space. So as beautiful as these paintings are, they'll never live up to the existence of the actual rose. You know, as good as this photograph of a croissant is, it's never going to be as good as eating it, you know? So what's the point of taking that photo or making that painting? And that's a, you know, sort of an existential issue that artists deal with continually. And, you know, I struggle with that sometimes. But really what it comes down to, what it boils down to, especially for our class, is that painting is in its own right something that's special, something that's celebrated, something that is beyond just the object, beyond just a photograph. It shows the artist's intention. It shows the artist's hand. You know, we've got three different roses here, and each of them are painted so differently from the other. And the quality of painting is so amazing in all of these. Like, I love how blocky and brushy this is. And I like how soft this background is over here and how soft it is right through here. And then this is very loose and unclear. And I like how that looks as well. And so the quality of paint is the thing that is transcendent, not the image. It's not the subject matter, but it's the actual activity of painting that becomes the important thing. Now, that's not painting for painting's sake. It's, you know, painting because, well, I guess it is painting for painting's sake, ultimately. But it's working on multiple levels. It's making you remember what a rose is like, but it's also showing you what painting is like. And I think that's exciting. I think that's an amazing thing to be able to do, to work in both, to kind of say two different things at the same time. This module was created with the intention of kind of working on the banal and really it was kind of a pursuit in understanding originality. You know, like I said, we go to the Eiffel Tower and everyone takes a picture of the Eiffel Tower. So we all end up with the same photo of the Eiffel Tower. And then other people see it and they're like, hey, I need to go to that place and I need to take that picture. And so it's not really an original thing. It's not like this idea is just kind of, we don't know where it began and we don't know where it will end, but we're all just kind of participating in it. And one of the things that I always hear in an art class is, you know, I want to be able to make original things. And that's, it's such a funny phrase to me, because it's like, I don't know what that means really. You know, we're all communicating with each other. You understand what I'm saying, because you've learned the same language I've learned. And we all agree that the words I say are meaningful in the way that I string them together. So it's not original at all. It's like, if I trace this back, my education and your education are the same. Like, we're all sort of believing the same thing. We're all using the same level of influence to kind of communicate with each other. And like I said, it's an existential question. Like, if we keep digging and chipping away at this, it becomes very like troublesome to think about what originality actually is, and if it even exists. And there's this funny video here on Vimodalan. It's a made up word, and it's, I forget what it's related to. It says it in the back of the end of the video. It's like something about common sorrows. Excuse me. Basically, this guy, he invented all of these words with funny definitions about like different attributes that would make you sad. And Vimodalan is the desire to take a photo, but then realizing that everyone else has taken the same photo. And it's a great little video, I think, that is kind of hits the nail on the head for this page here. So I suggest watching that one. But moving on, I want to talk a little bit about kind of the difference in attitudes towards art, or what artists may find inspiration from. You know, one of the things that art has always been about is wealth. And that's partly because making art takes a lot of materials. So, you know, it's hard to come by. You know, we can go to the store, we can go to Blick or whatever, but back in the day, you know, they had to grind up pigment. They had to weave canvas to stretch over wooden frames. And so that takes a whole kind of team of people that would put this thing together before the artist even touches it. And so it really was kind of in the realm of the wealthy. And so the wealthy wanted that wealth celebrated. So a lot of art kind of deals with extravagance and opulence, and we see that throughout history. But that doesn't just mean kind of money. It means sort of the abundance and excess of kind of the world. You know, we see fantastic things. So we have this Bosch painting here, again, sort of related back to those miniature paintings. And then we have this Caspar David Friedrich painting. And this is like very sublime, like in the Immanuel Kant kind of way, where nature is so much grander than we can really fathom. And so that's kind of what they're showing here. And so it's this very, very kind of grand moment. We see that through other paintings. This is a contemporary artist, Kehinde Wiley, and he's referring back to old Renaissance paintings or classical paintings, but putting sort of a contemporary twist on it. He's placing like different people into the painting from the streets. Like he'll walk around the streets of, I think he's from Harlem. And he went to Harvard. So when he got out of Harvard, he went back to New York, and he's just picking up people off the streets and having them model for him in their everyday clothes. And then he was placing them in these like Napoleonic paintings. This is a photograph by Andrea Andreas Gursky. And I mean, even at the 99 cent store, you know, where everything is inexpensive, you know, there's the, it's really about this abundance. It's really this grand scale of sort of the totality of everything. This is Picasso's Guernica. And, you know, just like that Persian painting, there's all of these vignettes happening, all of these moments that are intertwined and that we can kind of examine. This is the Infinity Room by Yayoi Kusama. And she's done this installation in a few different places, but you can actually go to the Broad in LA and go in there and take a photo of yourself, just like everyone else does. But it's really just Christmas lights in this like mirror room with water. There's like a little platform that you stand on, and then there's water. So as you look around, it's just infinitely twinkly. It's really quite amazing. And not just as a photo op, but just as an experience to kind of be in the middle of it. It feels like you're in outer space, honestly. It's really kind of amazing.
Now, where did you say that was?
This is in the Broad.
B-R-O-D-E?
B-R-O-A-D. It's a new museum. It's free to the public. Oh. Eli Broad is, he's a big collector of art. I think it was really his wife. And what are those houses? KB houses? KB Homes? I think it's KB. He's the B in KB Homes. He's a kind of real estate magnate.
It was Kaufman and Broad originally.
Kaufman and Broad. Okay. Yeah. KB Homes. Yes. Okay. Yeah, so he has a huge, extensive collection of art, and he created his own museum. And it's really amazing, and it's a lot of fun. This one, though, the mirror room, you have to make reservations for. And they go pretty quick. So you have like a 5-minute window, and you get to go in there and experience it.
Where's the museum?
It's on Grand, right across the street from the MoCA.
Yeah, and it's right next to the Disney Center too, the yes. Disney Concert Hall or whatever.
Yeah, correct. Yeah.
In downtown LA, basically.
Yeah. Definitely worth checking out. And then this last one is a piece by Tara Donovan. And these are all styrofoam cups glued together. Thousands of them. And it creates this really amazing kind of cloud formation that is both very warm because it's familiar. You know, you recognize that they're styrofoam cups, but it's off-putting because it's so gigantic in its scale. And it glows and it's weird. It's very weird in person. And you can kind of see the doorway for scale here. Kind of moving on from the opulence and extravagant kind of grandness of it all. We have Camp and Kitsch, and Susan Sontag wrote sort of the definitive essay, Notes on Camp. And you can read that right here. I have a little link to that. I'm not going to go too much into it in terms of like explaining it. I think the images can do better, but there is a distinction that I do want to make. And Kitsch is sometimes intentional and it's sometimes unintentional. It could be an accidental thing that is kitschy. But camp is very much intentional, where it's celebrating things that are kitsch. It's very deliberate in its examination and usage. But sometimes it's hard to like find where that line is, and they sometimes blur together. But basically, camp and kitsch are kind of like the things that people like that may not be good taste, like pink flamingos on the lawn kind of thing, which have their own charm, but that the way that we like that is a little bit kitschy, or it's a little campy, is how we would say that. We have this painting by Andy Warhol of three Elvises silk screened onto a canvas. You know, he's taking elements of popular culture and reinterpreting it. You know, here we have Elvis as this gunslinger, kind of repeated over and over again, almost like he's special enough to be on a painting, but not special enough because it's easy to replicate. So Warhol is very much in kind of the camp realm, where he's using it because I think he genuinely likes Elvis, but also he's maybe critiquing it because he genuinely likes Elvis. This is just a photograph of all of these tchotchkes this lady has. It's again hard to tell if, you know, is this all like, is she putting on an act, or is this who she really is? I think at a point it's both. This is a Jeff Koons piece. This is just a balloon dog made out of metal, and it sells for millions of dollars. And then we got this Live, Laugh, Love poster that occupies so many people's homes, you know, with this very kind of generic script writing. We've got lumberjack style, but not really lumberjacks. We have a golden toilet. This is by Mauricio Catalan. We've got these crazy suits made by Nick Cave, who makes these amazing outfits that no one would really wear. They're more like sculptural art pieces, kind of made up from the same patterns and fabrics that maybe this lady has, you know, in all of her dolls and closet. We've got the Las Vegas Strip, and this is a Mark Ryden. And all of these things are somewhat hollow, but also somewhat genuine. There's a real kind of enjoyment that happens with these pieces, but also maybe they're a little off-putting and challenging because they don't feel as like special as something else. They don't feel as like real. Here we've got Solvang, a small Dutch town in central California. And we've got this Dali painting. And maybe not this Dali painting per se. You know, I think Dali was very genuinely interested in certain things and conveying certain things, but maybe people that have this poster hanging in their wall. You know, this poster says something about who we are, just the way that like this poster does. Yeah. So that's like camp and kitsch. So we've covered the opulent end. We've covered the kind of campy end, and those two are very interconnected. And then on the far other end of everything, we've got the banal. And the banal is just common things. It's just something that is very normal and very ordinary. And you actually see this a lot in a lot of different ways. I have this great video here on cutaway shots, but the whole video is really great. In movies, they just add elements that don't really move the plot along, but just help you understand the context of the space. And it helps you understand that this is happening in a real world situation. So ordinary things kind of create a connection to us because we're familiar with them. You know, it's kind of like a warm blanket. I just watched it so I could remember the name, but I don't remember the name now. But this is a great video on this amazing photograph of, like, I don't even want to spoil it. You just have to watch the video. But it's a great photograph. It's really well done. The video is really well done, and they explain things in a very interesting way. But it's just a photo of houses. And that's something we all see. And the suburb kind of housing track is very common. We've got another painting or paintings by Andy Warhol. You know, this at this point in time is a little campy, you know, but Campbell soup cans are very common, very ordinary, but now we don't even think of Campbell soup cans as cans of soup. We only think of them as like this art piece by Andy Warhol. So it sort of transcended from ordinary into maybe a little campy. This Duchamp sculpture, Duchamp used a lot of what we term ready-made. So objects that he found that were already made and turned them into pieces of art. So he had no actual physical action making this object. This is a urinal turned on its side. He just went and bought it. And then he put it into the museum. So that context of taking something very common and shifting our focus becomes a very powerful thing. You know, the act of having like a bagel and making a painting of it all of a sudden elevates that bagel into something else. It's not just a bagel anymore. This Manet painting, aside from the fact that, you know, they look fairly well off and they're well-dressed people, it's like a snapshot. It's just a moment in time. They're not really doing anything spectacular. There's no event that they're associating with. It's just a man and a woman kind of resting on a bench. And it's not special, but it's kind of special because, you know, aside from the way that they're dressed, it feels like just an ordinary day. And that's kind of something amazing to celebrate. Here we have another painting by Gerhard Richter of just this woman reading a newspaper. Just a moment in time. Again, not anything spectacular, nothing overly somber. It's hard to get a read on anything, honestly, other than the fact that she's a woman, this is like a newspaper, and that's about it. This Estes painting is really quite amazing because of how hyper detailed and realistic it is. But aside from kind of the skill at painting that he has, it's nothing special. It's just a diner. It's just the front of a diner and some telephone booths. And it feels immediately familiar. It feels immediately like something that we could connect to and that we've experienced. And it's not grand, but in that moment, in that sort of way that it communicates to us, it's very spectacular. So the ordinary, the banal, has that ability to kind of deeply burrow itself into kind of our mind and our personal lives. This is a photo by Cindy Sherman, where she created these like film stills based on what she thought would have been movies from the 60s and 50s. This is a photo by Jeff Wall, and it looks like just a snapshot of two people in this apartment. But everything in here is placed. Everything in here is curated. So this was just an empty room that he bought all these lamps and furniture and made just to make this one photo. And it's a weird exercise in kind of creating the ordinary. And this is a sculpture by Dwayne Hansen of just this guy that looks like he's like a handyman kind of thing. And again, it's nothing special, but it's kind of, that's the point, that it is special because it's nothing special. That this takes it puts a magnifying glass on things that we wouldn't normally take a look at, things that we'd normally pass by. This was information on just more banal art. This is a Franz Klein, not banal at all. But I put him in here because I wanted to just show you like the painting is really about kind of the physicalness of the activity, not necessarily the subject matter. As we kind of root around for different subjects to paint, it really, the end of the day kind of thing is that we all have to paint. And the activity of painting is the thing that is also interesting, not just the subject matter. But for more artists, we've got this Phil Donahue. He's a photographer, not the TV show guy. And he just takes pictures of basically abandoned buildings or sort of almost abandoned buildings. And this is, I think, the mall out in Hemet. But it could be any place, honestly. And I think this is the mall in San Bernardino. But he goes all up and down the state. He's in other states as well. He goes across the country and takes these photographs that could easily be any place in any town that's sort of kind of fallen apart and trying to build itself back up and, you know, work through itself. This is Nick McPhail, and he paints these very in between spaces of the suburbs of kind of any city, any neighborhood. So like the stairway landing that goes up to the garage or down, I don't know. The front of an apartment building that's a little sun dappled, a lawn getting watered. And so the subject matter isn't really that interesting. and that's okay. What really becomes interesting is how it's painted. And so this idea of exploring the activity of painting, even without having the most riveting subject matter, is kind of like what we're also focused on. And then this is Nick Farhi. And he just does like Pyrex dishes and collectible cups and just this toaster oven, this glass and pitcher set. But just sort of this amazing painting of ordinary things. And then for this week's assignment, rather than painting the banal, I want you to celebrate kind of the opulent and the ostentatious. The things that are so extravagant and so elaborate. You know, I have this video here on why a Rolex watch is so expensive. And if you've ever seen like the inside of a watch, like a Rolex, it's got hundreds of tiny little pieces, all these small gears. Now, we could buy a Swatch watch and it works just as well. And it costs, you know, well, back in the day, it cost like $40 or $50. But it's a very simple device. It had maybe a very simple motor and, you know, that's it. But this thing has, like I said, hundreds of pieces. And so we pay for that level of detail and that level of craft that goes into creating this object. Jeff Koons is all about that. He's all about having this sort of heightened value of objects and making these things that are so pristine and so amazingly accurate and well made that it's a little off-putting. So for this one, we're painting basically whatever you have that is maybe the most kind of extravagant and important and detailed thing you may have. And if you're finding this thing online as an image, that's fine. But if you have something in mind, then that's great too. For me, I don't really have a lot of like fancy things. So I asked my wife what she had. And so she has this like cool ring with two ram heads that are like very intricately carved. And so I was like, oh, that's pretty cool. I mean, she's got some rings with like small diamonds set in there and some fancy stones, but I was really attracted to all the shape and detail that goes into making something like this. So this is what I'm gonna paint today. And you know, this is maybe the most kind of outrageous and gaudy thing that she has. It's relatively tiny. You can kind of see her hand here for scale. It's a ring. My other option was that we have a disco ball hanging in our house. And I was going to paint that because that's sort of like this crazy fancy thing. But I'm going to go with a ring instead. So this is what I'm going to paint here today. That's my background. But we'll go ahead and take a break here, 10 minutes, and I'm going to set up my paint stuff and we'll get to painting. Did you have any questions before we take a break? No? Okay. So we'll go ahead and take a break here and we'll be back. 10 minutes. Okay. So let me just I shared the image to the chat so you can take a look at it, but we'll take a look at the image together here. So I've already drawn it out, and when it comes to gold and any metallic surface, the trick is to really get a sense of the sharpness of information. And what I mean by that is, if we look at this, I'm going to zoom in here. There you go. If we look at this, we've got these very light areas and we've got these really dark areas and kind of the medium value areas as well. But what we could do is we can see that there's a very distinct edge to those areas here. there's very little in terms of like graduated color. So it doesn't blend from one side to the other side. Okay, it does a little bit in here, but really I'm getting a lot of distinct color changes with a hard edge through a lot of these shapes. And so that's the thing that I want to continue to do and replicate, is those hard edge shapes. So very distinct linear shapes. Yeah. So that's kind of the basic trick with anything metallic, is to get that very sharp hard edge. So that means that for the ring, and actually if we look at this part, so let me see if I can zoom down here. If we look at this part here, you can see that there's no blending that's happening. It's like we've got this light, dark, medium, dark, medium, or dark, medium sort of, and then a light, and that's it. And they're very linear, they're very distinct. They don't blend from one to the other. We have this really abrupt light area here that runs right up into this like medium value color right there. And so we just want to make sure that we replicate that kind of mark making. We're not trying to blend things together. So what that means for us, as we take a look at this, is that this here needs to be pretty sharp. In terms of technique, I can't really use like a wet into wet, because then it'll just start bleeding and I'll lose that edge. I want to maintain that edge. So this is going to be a very dry painting, kind of it, relatively compared to everything else. What I might do though, because this background is very blurry, this I might do kind of wet into wet. And I kind of laid out in the drawing a lot of these shapes. I might do that towards the end. That way we're not just sitting around waiting for paint to dry. But I think I'll sort of intentionally make this looser out here and let it bleed and work on the painting sort of wet. I'm going to start off with the ring because that's sort of the main thrust of this. The fingers may even be kind of wet into wet, but I might add some sharpness because there's a little bit of clarity here compared to the background. So that's what I'm going to do here. So let's switch on over to
Mark. Can I ask you a question?
Yes.
When you have an opulent object like this, how do you decide what you actually paint? Do you take a detail out of it? Do you maybe just paint the whole ring? As you suggested, you also paint the finger that holds up the ring. So what is the most effective way to go about this?
I think, you know, if I had like a nice ring stand, I would have done that. It didn't look quite as clear when it was on her finger. So I just had her hold it. I'm going to include the fingers because I think that helps with the scale. That we'll understand what it is that we're looking at. And it's like, oh, this is a piece of jewelry because this is a hand holding it. I think if you were to say, take a piece of it, it kind of loses some of the context. So if I were to only paint, say, like this part of the head here, like if I zoomed in and just painted like this section, then we don't really understand what it is that we're looking at. It could just be some sort of like art object that we have. But I feel like context kind of helps us make more sense of the painting. Mm-hmm. Is that?
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Yeah. Or you could take the both of the heads, right?
Yeah. Yeah. So I could have like, yeah, sort of done like this section here. But I do feel like having the object kind of in the hand, like pinched between the fingers, kind of shows how big or how small this thing is. Mm-hmm. And it kind of shows, again, that context of like, oh, this is going to be a piece of jewelry without mm-hmm. it being on the actual finger. Mm-hmm. The face, like when it was on the finger, it obfuscated the ring a little bit too much. So I feel like this was a nicer view of it.
Okay, thank you.
Sure. Okay, so switch on over to here. And let me zoom out a little bit. And then... What's up? All right, so here's my drawing. You can see I tried to be pretty detailed with it. I maybe missed some of the information. I feel like I can kind of get in there and add it or do it as needed. Yeah, sorry, I'm just sort of moving things around. I did do a painting for my beginning class, and that one was the banal painting, and I painted a box of tissue paper, so just so you can see that painting. So there's a box of tissue paper and kind of on
from anathan.com. Tissue paper refers to light crepe paper.
Mark,
yes,
on that tissue paper, the actual tissue, you know how it's wrinkled and you show the wrinkles?
Uh-huh.
What's the how do you do that? I mean, I realize it's values, but how do you pick where to?
It really comes down to shape. It comes down to trusting, like, in the image, the actual shapes of value that I'm seeing. So I don't know if you remember the, I think we did it at the beginning. It's the understanding the image assignment, where it was like a still life. And I asked you to trace out each of the different grays that you were seeing. That's the same thing. So except in a color image, you'd go through and trace out all of the different value shapes, and whatever those value shapes are on your drawing, that's what you're painting, is that value shape in whatever color, whatever value it may be. So for all of the folds here, it's really about the shapes and values. And you can actually see, so let me zoom in on this. You can kind of see all of the different lines that I drew here, denoting where those values are. Now, I could have erased this, but I'm not really, it doesn't really matter to me. But that's exactly kind of what's happening in, move this, in this image here, is all of those small little intricate shapes are those different values. I'm not drawing a ram's head or a horn or whatever, you know, an eyeball or anything. I'm just drawing the shape of the value, and that's really all it is. And as long as you trust that, that's the thing that will translate the image, because that is the image. Like, that's the way the image is made. So all I'm really doing is being like a human printer at this point, where I'm just putting the correct color in the correct shape in the correct location. Okay. All right. So like I said, I'm going to start off with the head here, and looking at the color, you know, when we think of gold, like, we think yellow. And it's definitely in the yellow family. I feel like the highlights are very yellow, kind of a whitish yellow. So I'm going to maintain that. But when I'm looking at sort of the other areas, I've got some really deep blacks. And then I've got this like muddy, orangey color, maybe like a yellow orange. The only issue is when you mix yellow with black, it turns green. So I kind of want to be conscious about that. So instead of using black, I think I'm gonna try and mix some brown with this. So I've got my brown here, I've got my black here, I've got some yellow there. I might squeeze out some new yellow so it's not as dry. yeah. So I think that's my general game plan. So I'm gonna do, I think, the darks first, and then kind of do the middle values. And that should be kind of good enough for the ring. So let me squeeze out a little bit of some fresh yellow. I feel like that one takes a while for me to like loosen up. And I do have a couple different yellows here that I could play with. Wash. All right. So for my palette here, this is this lemon yellow. So I'm just going to squeeze this into this pile here. So just some fresh color. And then this other one is yellow ochre, which is sort of a neutralized yellow. And you can make yellow ochre if you mix a little bit of violet with some yellow. It'll neutralize that color because they're complementary. But rather than having to go through all that, I can just put some yellow ochre out on my palette and mix it up. I think it's right there, but I can just squeeze that a little bit more. Yeah, that's a little brighter, obviously. So that's going to kind of give me the right range of color. I have all my other colors as well, so I can make some adjustments as needed. I'm just going to kind of pre-spray this just to help loosen some of that paint up and also get a little bit of water on my palette so I'm not having to add as much from the cups. Okay. So I like to start, for this one, I'm going to start with like the black. I think I'm going to go like black and brown. So it's not just so dull and it's kind of achromatic. So I've got my black here. And I'm going to use a small brush because this is already very detailed. And I don't want to go overboard with how dark this stuff goes. I might use a bigger brush for some of the bigger areas, but for this small stuff, I'm going to use the small brush. Maybe a little more brown. I want this thing to have some color, some warmth to it. So I've got this brown working with that black. Honestly, it goes a little green, I think. So I'm going to add just a touch of this yellow ochre to it. It might have been too much. I got too much on my brush. Blacks tend to be kind of on the cooler side. So that's why when you add yellow to it, it turns kind of greenish. I can make that a bit darker. I mean, on screen, that's really inky right now. For me, it's not quite black. So that's kind of what I want. All right. I'm just gonna take the water off of my brush. So I'm just dealing with paint because really what I want is kind of a sharp, precise bit of information. And I'm just gonna kind of tackle this. It's pretty small. So I'm just gonna build in kind of slowly and methodically. I just need to find my spot and figure out where I'm at here. And I think the easy one for me to get right now is this shape. So I'm just going to paint this in. It's a little watery. You can kind of pick up more paint so it goes darker. Yeah, I added too much water to that. So I'm just adding more pigment to the pile. Yeah, there you go. And just kind of working my way around. And I'm referring back to my image as I'm painting this. I'm not just filling in I'm following the shapes that I've pre-drawn, but I'm also very aware of what's happening in the image. as it kind of goes across here, it lightens up a little bit. So I'm just going to pull some of that paint off, pick up a little bit of that browner paint there, and just let that kind of bleed together a little bit. But still stay kind of dark. And the same is true kind of out here towards these edges. So I'm just going to let that paint kind of bleed out into some of these spots here. So now that I've done that, what that does is it kind of helps me key into where the other shapes are that I'm seeing. So like that's supposed to. Let's see here what happened. This shape right here. It's that one. You just kind of have to trust that this is kind of going to turn out the way that you want it to. Like it looks very fragmented right now, and that's kind of the way that that's going to look for a bit. So, especially if you're doing like jewelry or anything metallic like this. That's the way that goes. All right. I'm just going to jump in. I want to do this larger shape out here. It's a little bit lighter kind of here, but it's still pretty dark. So I'm just going to block that in. Bring some paint right there on the inside. Okay. So again, I'm just looking for these like dark shapes. I'm just trying to block them in. Now this is very intricate, so these shapes are on the smaller side. If your object was larger, then it wouldn't be as intricate. So I'm painting on the small side. Compared to maybe how I normally would approach a painting. I'm simplifying some of these values out. There is a little bit of some like variation that's happening, but I feel like I can just simplify them and turn them into like a big dark shape. What's that? What am I looking at there? So I'm a little bit lost. I don't quite know what that one is. It's the light one. Okay. So it took just a minute for me to kind of get my bearings and figure out where I'm at. Making my way. That's with something metallic like this, contrast plays a huge role. So making sure that you have enough dark on there to really let those lights feel as bright as they should feel is kind of the important thing as well. Like the brights won't look bright enough if there's not enough dark that's happening. So that's looking pretty good. Might come in here, pick up a few more things.
Okay, cool.
I'm going to move on to this one here. But my next step is to, once I do the darks over here, I'm going to come back in with the medium values, and then I think it'll all start to come together even more. So let me just kind of go through this part. Actually, let me zoom in here. Let me focus it a little bit. Let's go. Just making my way. So I'm not being linear about, I'm not making an outline around this. I'm just painting the shapes. And so if some of those shapes happen to be lines, then that's what I'm painting. And if I mess up a little bit, like if I don't put it in the right place, that's not a big deal either. As long as I kind of keep the same sort of attitude towards the information, if it's a little bit off, who's going to double check me? I'm getting a bit confused with this. What's that? Yeah, there it is. We're running out of paint here, so I gotta make a little bit more. Oh, it all sort of fell down there. that's pretty good. Such an intricate painting. I want it to be darker. So now here I'm just kind of winging this, like I'm not going overly specific. I feel like I can just get enough of a sense of like what that shape is that I can make it up a little bit. That looks pretty good. Missing that one. Sometimes it also helps to just like block it and just make it even more simple. Not to get too detailed. That's a little bit darker inside there. So I'm just going to bring that through. A little bit of a fine point there. So now I'm in this like that carved area of the ring. So I'm just trying to like get a sense of where things go. Making sure that I leave enough light area right next to the dark area. simplify that out a little bit. It sometimes helps to, like, I feel like that's getting a little too fussy. So I just want to make sure that I'm blocking in more than I'm outlining. So wherever I have that opportunity to maybe simplify some of those shapes out, I'll do so. All right, now I'm down to the actual ring part. I just want to make my way back up and just double check on some things that I felt I missed right here. Sorry, missed that part. Thanks. So I want to let that dry up a little bit. I'm going to do this just a little darker. There you go. So I'm going to let that dry up a little bit, and then I'm going to do the medium values. The medium values are much more abundant, but I just want to also be aware as well, I apply those medium values, that I stay away from the really light areas. And I think on this pass, it'll all start to come together a little bit more. It'll all start to look more like an actual ring. It'll start to look like gold or metallic. So for this one, I'm going to, I think I'm going to go for that yellow ochre. So I'm just going to, oh, you can't see my palette. Oh my gosh, hold on. I'm going to use a slightly bigger brush. Clean water here, because I could be a little more loose with this. So I've got my yellow ochre. I'm going to mix right down here. Got some yellow ochre, like so. That's kind of the base. And then I'm going to pick up just a little bit of this black just to help neutralize that a bit. So just, oh, that's a lot. I'm going to try to scoop some of that out. Just maybe more yellow now at this point. But it's giving me this like muddy color. I think it needs a little more yellow in there. There you go. Just more water in that. Yeah. My palette's not fully clean, so I've got some green in there. It's not that big of a deal. Actually, you know what? This was pretty cool. Yeah, that's pretty good. So I'll add a little more black on that side. That way I can kind of like pick and choose as I need. All right. So now I'm gonna come back over here to this side while this one dries. I'm again staying away from any of the really light areas and just blocking in, just thinking about that middle value range that is present. Okay. It's a little dull, so I want more color than that. That's good. This feels a little far from me. Let me just move this here. Got a lot of like hot moments right up in here. So I'm just gonna just maybe kind of dance around a few of these edges just to create some interference. So this mouth is painted, and this nose is also painted. Okay. A lot of hot moments in there. I think I can do this area right there. And some of this, that right there. Sides of the eye. And so right now I'm staying away because my brush is on the big side. I'm staying away from any of the really small, delicate areas and just trying to get the bigger, broader strokes in. I can always come back with a small brush and tighten some of these moments up here. That's good. There's a little bit of my value there. I'm gonna come in just a little bit darker. One second, sorry. I think for this part, I'm going to switch over to my small brush because it's getting kind of a little on the intricate side. A bit there.
What size brush did you switch to?
This is my 6 round. So I went from a 10 to a 6. There. So I'm just picking up a little bit of these smaller details now. Kind of crunching some of the information a little bit. I mean, that right there is starting to look pretty good. with this ring, there's areas that are more yellow. So like this white area here is more yellow. And then I have some that are a little bit more kind of orangey because it's picking up the reflected color from her finger. But what that's going to do is it's going to let the white parts feel even more hot. So I'm going to come in with some color here in a second. like on the next round. But I mean, it's starting to look pretty golden at this point. And that's really just kind of three different values at work here. The dark, the middle, and then the light value. Once I separate that light value a little further, and I can also go into that middle value and create some distinction as well, that's also going to create a lot of form and structure. All right, so I'm going to move on. That's good for now. Just double checking. Yeah, that's good for now. And then I'm going to do the same thing over on this side. So again, kind of looking for those middle values. I'm getting a little too light over here, so just a bit more black in there. Some yellow ochre. Maybe go back to my big brush here. So I'm not being overly fussy. One of the things you could do is by changing your brush size, it sort of challenges you to only deal with the information that the brush can really deal with. So it's not like I can get in there and be too detailed and too tight about things because my brush really wouldn't allow that. So I just have to kind of block things in and just let it be. Yeah, all right, let's come along. this area here, it gets a little confusing with this, with the horn there. Pretty good. All right. This one, I'm just, because I kind of made it up a little bit, I'm just going to also sort of make that up a little bit. Fine. One of the things you could also do is use like a white paint pen or like a white gel pen and come back in and get some really hot highlights in here or some gouache. Like that's always an option. So there's a lot of this area here that is just kind of like in some shadow. I just want to make sure I pick up some of those highlights in there just to create some variation in dimension. But it doesn't not necessarily need a lot. That's good. Kind of light over on that side. Using a little bit of that color there. So a slightly darker edge on this side. So let me zoom out a little bit. Then we can maybe see it a little bit fuller. Maybe a little zoom in here. There you go. So it's I think that's looking pretty good. It doesn't quite read completely clear yet. I feel like this is way too fragmented still. So I'm going to come in with some yellow and yellow ochre just to kind of bring in some of that medium light value. And I can use that same color for some of these other highlights. So mix that out. So I've got some yellow ochre. You can't see my color. Oops. some yellow ochre, and then just some pure yellow here. And I'm just going to mix the two sort of side by side and let them kind of mix in what I feel is the right amount. I think you can't even see that, sorry. There you go. So that's kind of where I'm at. a bit of water on that. Take some of the water off. So now that's like these areas here. This area here. Some of this here. A little bit of that. This whole thing here, there. That one. Those two. So I'm being selective about what I'm keeping and what stays white and what kind of doesn't. Those are quite white. These are actually on the pinkish side, but I'm just going to stick with this yellow for right now. Yellow is such a soft color that it's easy to kind of paint right over it. Oh yeah, look at that. It's funny how that works. That's pretty good. So now the remaining white areas of that head all of a sudden are really starting to like come together and feel like a really nice highlight. So I'm gonna do the same thing over on this one. Just try to figure out where I'm at. So I'm really only keeping the brightest highlights white. Everything else is getting this little bit of like a color wash on it. That's just going to help tie everything together. There's a little bit of like some interference stuff happening up through here. I need to go a little darker. I can pick up more color, more yellow ochre. That's going to help kind of make that feel not as bright.
So if you were doing something that was clear, you know, like crystal type thing, what would you do as far as colors?
So the crystal would be whatever the color is that's sort of surrounding it. Let me just do this, and I'll actually go grab some glass or something, and I can show you.
Glass or diamonds or, you know, that kind of thing. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Clear, but sort of gray, sort of not colored.
Yeah. It really comes down to like the surrounding color and how you're seeing the object kind of through it, but also for like a diamond. If you're looking at the different facets of the diamond, each facet will be its own sort of like color. It'll be its own different value. So you just do that and kind of keep it all segmented the way that you're seeing it. But I can go grab like a diamond. I see it
clear.
Well, you think you see it clear, but what you're actually seeing tends to not, what you think you see is not really what you're actually observing. And I'll sort of show you what I mean by that. Okay, cool. So let me let that dry for a second. I'll be right back. I'm going to grab something that's like crystal-ish or diamond-ish. I'll be right back.
Thanks.
All right, so move this out really quick and I can talk about this. All right, so I got this like weird flower thing here. I also have a cup. And this diamond thing, paperweight thing. This one is iridescent and it has like a tinted mirror finish on it. So you can kind of like see the different colors in there. This is like a, I don't know, like a crystal candle holder. One of the little guys fell off. And so you can kind of see this a bit better here. Let me zoom in on that. Okay. So when you're looking at something, and this is a glass, when you're looking at something that is clear or see-through, what you're really observing is the information behind it, right? So it's not like you're painting a clear thing. You're just painting a distorted thing that's behind it. So this grid is kind of a great example of being able to see. So here we can see this crystal. We've got the grid here. And the grid is a consistent line that goes all the way across from one side to the other. But as it goes through this crystal structure, what you're really seeing is that line kind of shifts again, and then it goes back to kind of its neutral setting. Here, that the information goes like it shifts over here, shifts over this way, shifts over this way, and then resets back to its setting. Now, in this case, you know, this grid is kind of a great example of that, but you're also seeing kind of the different facets here. So the highlight of that and the way that the light is sort of interacting with the color that's happening behind it. With this one, we're not really getting too much color interference, but let's take a look at this glass here. So with this glass, with this glass. let me grab something that I can point with. With this glass, we're seeing that shift of information that's happening in terms of the patterning, but also we can see this shape of a highlight here, right? So this highlight is a very distinct light shape. You can see that one there. And then we have that dark shape. That dark shape isn't really that dark though. That dark shape is really almost the same color and value as the background. Does that make sense? So they're very similar. The patterning you can see, if you can kind of make it out and zoom in, this grid pattern is starting to warp as it goes around kind of the curvature of the glass, like that glass curves, right? As it kind of flattens out and faces us, those lines become straight, and then you can kind of see them start to curve up again in this direction here. You can see that with a thicker line there. Because this is also a reflected surface, you're getting these pops of color, very distinct in terms of their shape, which are reflected from these colors over here on the palette, right? So if I were to shift this, it would shift those colors. You can kind of see that happen, right? But really, this object isn't clear per se, it's just shape. It's just shape of color, shape of value. So if you were copying it, whether you're observing it from real life or from a photograph, really you're drawing this light shape. You're drawing this dark shape here. And then you're drawing like whatever's next to it, like this dark shape here, this light shape there, this medium shape there, this dark shape here, over to like these shapes and these shapes. And that's really all it is. You know, obviously with all of these facets, it becomes very complicated in terms of like what that color is doing and how it's changing. But as long as you're specific about that shape, that value, and its position, it'll look like what it's supposed to look like. So all of these facets here, they're just different shapes. It's confusing and very intricate, but if you slow yourself down enough, you could actually copy each one of those different shapes, right? So I hopefully that kind of clears it up. So if you're drawing a glass, if you're drawing, you know, a clear object, you're not really drawing a clear object. You're just drawing a shape of value. It would be the same thing if you were drawing a solid object. You're just drawing the shape of value, ultimately. I find that that's kind of the best approach to dealing with all of this is thinking about shape rather than the whole entirety of the thing. So if you just think of it like broken into shapes.
So if it's, I don't know what color I could pick.
Well, so
like a sapphire stone.
Sure.
It's blue. it's tiny and, you know, like how do you, maybe it's because of the size.
I got a whole bunch of candy in my cup here. so this is a amber colored glass, right? So, you know, it's almost kind of solid looking, but look at what's happening right here. Right here, we're seeing a different color than this, right? And it doesn't matter that this is an amber colored glass or that this is a clear colored glass. Really, all that matters is here I have a shape, right? This, I can kind of outline that. And this color is, I don't know, looks yellow green to me. right? And then right below it, you know, I can use the same edge. I have a shape here. And this shape here is more yellow than green, but it's still a little greenish. And then I have a shape here. And these are, this is like a darker sort of reddish orange color. And that's my shape. And then I have a shape here. And this is, but I can break that down even further. I can be smaller information. I can say, okay, I have a shape right there. I have a shape right there. I mean, you can kind of go crazy and say, I got this shape and this shape and this shape and this shape, but you can simplify that a little bit. You know, I've got this shape here, this dark orange, red orange with some black in it. Like that's a shape right there. You know, even though we know the glass is yellow, what we see, what we observe is that this is a yellow green shape. This is a red orange shape. This is a black shape. This is a white shape. This is a white shape as well. Right. So again, it's not like whatever the object is. I mean, it has some influence, but whatever it is that you're seeing, that's what you draw. That's what you paint. So even though we know that this piece of glass here is clear, what are we really seeing? We're seeing green, right? You know, if I put it on my hand is sort of in like the reddish family. Now, all of a sudden, what are we seeing? Even though it's clear, it's red, right? If I were to put this on top of something else, so I have a white piece of paper there, green there, and I have half of it on the white and half of it on the green, and you can see it a little bit better if I block out the sun. The shape and color that you see is whatever the shape and color is that you see. So you're not...
What about that edge? You see where it crosses the white paper,
uh-huh,
and the edge. Like, otherwise you would just paint it white. How do you define that edge?
Well, this is a great thing here. So there you go. Look at that highlight right there. You see that little highlight?
The tiny, tiny, yes.
The tiny, tiny little highlight. Mm-hmm. You can also see it right here. Mm-hmm. So we know that this piece of paper, this paper towel, is a local color of white, meaning that the object itself is white, but the color that we actually see isn't white. This little highlight is white. This is darker. Does that make sense? So this edge, this little highlight here, is creating that edge. We're getting some level of like variation between one thing and the other. And that's really all we see. From here to here, those things blend together to me. Like I can't see a difference. But over here, I've got this little highlight. I've got another little highlight. I got a little shadow there. And I've got a little highlight there. And that's creating sort of an implied edge of where that crystal is. You can see that here, right? This white highlight here is creating the edge. But in other instances, maybe like this to this, it blends together. And so that edge disappears. And so you don't have to invent anything that you don't actually see. Whatever it is that you see, that's what you paint, because that's how you actually see it. Your brain is saying that there's an edge here, even though you don't really observe it. You're just kind of like, yeah, I know there's an edge there because there's an object there, but it kind of disappeared. So understanding that, you know, color changes, and that even though the object is white, doesn't mean that it's actually white, is kind of an important thing. So here's white right there. This is a white paper towel. This is definitely white. This is not. Right? So if I was going to paint this, I would leave this highlight here untouched. That would be the white of the paper, whereas the paper towel would have some color or value on it. Cool?
Yep.
Okay.
Thank you.
Great explanations. Yeah, perfect. Sure. Thank you.
Sure. Let me kind of put my candy away here. Oh, there I dropped them. All right. So let's see, go back to this. So let me zoom out a little bit. You can see how that ring kind of came together, and really it's I think at this stage four values at work. Let me zoom in one more. There you go. It's just that dark value, the medium value, the lighter medium value, which is like the yellow that I did, and then the white. And it's really about creating those distinct edges. So that's true with metal surfaces. That's true with glass, because it's super reflective. And generally that's sort of the usual suspects when it comes to sort of this subject matter, is something like really ornate is going to be jewelry or crystal or whatever. And so this was kind of the different thing today. We're sort of running out of time here. What I'm going to do is I'll continue the painting. I'm basically done with the ring. All I need to work on is the negative space. And for the negative space, what I'm going to do is I'm going to make it a lot softer. So I'm going to do wet into wet. I'm going to kind of soak my paper using my mop brush. So there's my mop brush. I'm going to wet the paper down, and I'm just going to like let those colors kind of fade and bleed into one another. And that's just going to create some softness that's going to help differentiate from how sharp and tight I painted the ring. For the fingers, I'm going to do the same kind of treatment, but maybe I'm going to come in and define some of those edges a little bit. I don't want it to visually compete. I just don't want it to like be this weird blob of like pink down here. It needs to make enough sense that you understand that it's a finger and this is a fingernail. So it's going to be tighter than the background, but not as tight as the ring. I'm gonna videotape myself painting it, and then I'll do like a sped up version of the painting, and I'll post the painting to sort of the page with the Zoom link for this Zoom session. So that way you can watch it when I complete it. Are there any last questions? So I can kind of switch out of here and talk to you face to face.
No, it was a quiet class, Mark, so thank you very much. I think we learned a lot again this semester, so. And especially this last class was the finishing touch, you know, how to do gold and crystal, you know, so
yeah.
Thank you. Yeah.
You're welcome. Yeah, you know, we covered a lot of painting, a lot of different assignments. Please feel free to continue to submit your work. I'm going to leave feedback so that way you have access to it. Even some of the old stuff, feel free to turn those things in. Moving forward, hopefully you continue to paint. Hopefully you found this class enjoyable. Please don't hesitate to ever reach out. You can contact me anytime, either through school email or my personal email, which is mbatongmalake. So that's just first initial last name at gmail.com. What else? I had a lot of fun. This was a great class. I really appreciate your engagement with it. I really love all the work that I've seen, and it's been a really great sort of way to kind of ease back into sort of teaching face-to-face almost. And yeah, so it's been a lot of fun. I'm always nervous when I do these paintings in class, because I'm like, I don't know if they're going to turn out. So it's always like a bit of a gamble for me.
Oh my gosh, it's so helpful. I think, at least for me it is. I think, sure. I don't know about everybody else, but the way you describe what you're doing, what you're thinking, your hesitations, when you dip the brush in water, or how much paint, what order you're dipping the, you know, mixing everything.
Yeah,
it's really helpful.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, you know, it's, I feel like it's a bit of a journey when you're painting. For me, you know, I'm not classically trained per se. So it's still, I mean, I've been painting for a good long while now, but I'm still learning. I'm still figuring things out. And I try to be as kind of transparent about like whatever issues I might have. So this was a great format to kind of show that and like demonstrate that, yeah, even I kind of struggle with a moment, and I might have to just like leave it be for a minute and walk away for a second. So I think that's a helpful to you all, and I appreciate that you guys enjoyed the class and that you liked the format of it. I'm teaching again in the spring. So if you haven't signed up, I am teaching the same class. So please feel free to jump in. I'm still kind of reworking and trying to figure out what it's going to be. I do want to kind of give you more in terms of sort of free range to kind of do different things. But we'll see. I mean, I feel like this format works pretty well, but we'll try to like mix things up. So, okay. Other than that, I think that's about it. Have a great holiday. Have a great new year. And don't forget about the golden. Is it golden?
Yes. And yeah, if anybody golden. Has trouble signing up, they can email me and I'll email you the link. If you just email me, then I'll email you the original, and you might have better luck.
Okay. Yeah, I'm gonna post it at the end of the module, the link for the golden demo, and that's on Wednesday, January 11th from 9 to 11. Yeah. But have a great week. Have fun painting, and see you all soon. Okay.
Thank you, Mark.
Thank you.
All right. Bye.
Thank you. Thanks a lot. Bye.
Bye.
Bye.